an Irish bar. Walking along Charlestown, wishing you were in Bannerstrand. Holding your nephew's hands, we walked along the waterfront, up Bunker, down on Main. We met at the monument, where everyone knew our names. Our first kiss on 40 flights, our friends on the stoop on summer.
Good evening and welcome to Charlestown Live. I'm your host, Abby Gray, and we have a great show for you this evening. Before we get started, I'd like to thank our sponsor, Chad, Charlestown Against Drugs, and I'd like to welcome you to the show. We have a great guest this evening, and Grimes Rand, who's the president of the Constitution Museum. Is that the correct title?
That's right.
The USS Constitution Museum. Before we start talking about the Constitution, the museum, and when she goes into dry dock, which I really think there's so many amazing things that are going to be happening in relationship to her going into dry dock for residents and tourists, that I want to spend as much time on that as possible. I just want to go over a couple announcements that are in the bridge. First of all, you can... reserve now for the Bunker Hill Day parade ads. They are taking those reservations and they'll be the annual issue that they do. There's the fundraiser for the Charlestown Working Theater, which is always comedy night, which is always hysterical, and they are selling tickets for that now. And the Charlestown Soccer fall registration is open, so please take note if you have children who want to register. That is open now, and I believe it goes through, and there'll be tryouts. So you can go to the website, which is Charlestown Youth Soccer. I think you can just Google Charlestown Youth Soccer, and then you can get the whole schedule, but it's also in your neighborhood roundup. So let's jump into the show. Anne, thank you for coming.
Sure, happy to be here.
So you do have a lot to say about everything that's going on, from what's going to happen with the ship coming out and something fun you just told me about on Sunday, through what exhibits are going to happen. So why don't you just jump into it and tell us everything we need to know.
Okay, well, it's going to be an exciting week in Charlestown
because
USS Constitution is headed into dry dock overnight, Monday into Tuesday morning.
Okay.
By Tuesday morning at sunrise, Tuesday, May 19th, you should see the whole ship's hull exposed there below the waterline and glistening in the sun. So the activity actually starts tomorrow morning.
Okay.
Constitution is going to leave her berth and move around to closer to where Cass and Young usually is, waiting just outside dry dock number one in the Charlestown Navy Yard.
Which is right next to the museum.
So right, the activity is all gonna be taking place in the dry dock right in front of the museum.
Okay.
So starting tomorrow morning, she moves over, Constitution moves over. So first Cass and Young needs to move aside, let Constitution out of her berth. Constitution comes around and ties up on the other side, and that's sort of the activity for Friday morning. Cass and Young will tie back up. And then on Sunday, as we were just discussing, Sunday morning is when they will flood the dry dock in front of the museum.
Oh, okay.
So
is that something that people should come and see?
So it is fun to see the dry dock at work. I mean, that is an engineering marvel. The dry dock in front of the museum was built in 1833. The oldest it's the second oldest dry dock in the country because the one in Virginia opened a week before ours did.
But Virginians.
They were both designed by Loammi Baldwin.
Okay.
So when you come to the museum, we have an exhibit about the dry dock and what will be happening to Constitution. So you can see the builder's original model of the dry dock in the museum. That's on display now. And on Sunday morning, I think we have an image showing the water coming into the dry dock that we'll be able to share with people. So you will see the water floods through the gate. The caisson is the name of the gate at the end of the dry dock. So water comes flooding through the gate, and that sort of fills up the giant bathtub in front of the museum.
I think we have that picture. Do we have that picture?
So we do have that picture.
Okay, can we put some of the pictures on? And also, I forgot to mention, Anne, that this is a call-in show. So if anybody has questions for Anne regarding the Constitution Museum or the Constitution, feel free to call 617-708-3290. I forgot to mention that, sorry. So here we have a picture.
So you are seeing a view of what Constitution will look like when she is in the dock overnight on Tuesday. She's coming in at night because the highest tide is just after midnight. Okay. So she will actually be sort of lining up in front of the dry dock about 9:30. By about 10:30, there should be enough water to start moving her into the dock, and then they close the gate behind her. So you have a ship and a dock full of water, and then overnight they'll be pumping out the water. So this is what you see on the screen now, shows a view of the ship when the water has all been pumped out. And maybe by 4 a.m. or so, that may be what you would see this time around on Tuesday morning.
Okay.
And we have a couple more images. This takes you to the far end when the work is completed in dry dock. Being in dry dock allows the crew to work on the ship below the waterline. So you can see how much of the ship's hull is exposed there. We're looking at Constitution's stern, and you can see the amazing lines of the ship in dry dock. You're also seeing brand new copper sheeting that has been installed on the ship's hull. And there are about 3,400 sheets of copper that are installed on the ship's hull.
Wow.
So when you
When was that done?
So the last time it was done when she was in dry dock in the 1990s.
Okay.
So this is a shot showing her in 1995 when she was looking beautiful and getting ready to leave the dry dock. And we can look at a couple more images. This is the view from in the 1990s when they were flooding the dock. And you can see we're looking down to the far end. The gate or the caisson at the end of the dock has holes in it that lets the harbor water flow in.
Okay.
So when the tide is higher outside, water flows in through the gate there. And you can see right in the middle there are the blocks in the center of the dock that Constitution will sit on. And you can see in this photo, there's a little bit of a curve to match the ship's hull. In the 1990s, that was a higher curve than it is now. Now it's only about 6 inches.
So. Oh, really?
Yep, so you flood the dock. What you see here is the new gate, the new caisson that has just been built over the last year. So that is a brand new gate that you will see being used in the dock during this restoration. And you can also see 4 little round shots on the front of it, which is where the water will flow through this gate.
Okay. And that gate is, I see where.
So that's now in the water. So you will see that this is when it was just arriving about a month ago, and it's being lowered off of the barge that was built in Virginia. It came up on a barge, and they are just lowering it off into the water here.
Okay. Let's see. Oh.
And this is a little sample of the sort of work that you will see when they replace a plank on board Constitution. So it's the skilled craftspeople at the Naval History and Heritage Command, Detachment Boston. Those are the civilians who work for the Navy who maintain the ship year-round.
Oh.
So you will see lots of folks working in the dry dock there.
Is there just a crew for the Constitution?
There's a full-time year-round crew for the Constitution of about 25 folks, and then they hire extra folks during the restoration.
Okay.
So now there are more folks helping out. And I think this is our last view from the dry dock, where you're right down at the ship's keel, the very bottom of the ship there. You can see resting on the keel blocks. Again, we're at the end of the restoration when her copper is all shiny and new and newly installed. I can show you right here live a little piece of copper that we have brought. When the copper comes off of the ship, it's actually weathered and green from having spent all that time in the water. And the reason you put copper on a ship to start with is to keep teredo worms or organisms that like to eat wood, to keep them from eating the ship's wood. If you have a copper sheet on the outside, that protects the ship's hull. Oh. Just like today on modern boats, people still use copper anti-fouling paint to keep barnacles or mussels from growing.
In our house, we have copper gutters.
Okay.
Yeah.
There you go. Right. It's a good material. And this is what a new piece of copper, the sheets that go on the ship are actually about 4 feet long and 14 inches wide. But if you come and visit the museum, you can talk to a sailor who serves on Constitution, and you can sign your name on a copper sheet that will be installed on the ship in a couple of years once they've done all the work they need to do.
Oh, that's neat. So they will be taking the copper that was replaced in 95, and then they will be replacing it with new copper.
Yep.
Why is that? Is that because it doesn't look like it's been damaged?
It has actually lost a fair amount of its volume.
Oh.
So it's not only, you're right, if you just left this in place, it would still be doing its job. But in order to get in to do the work on the wooden planks below the water line, you need to take the copper off first, get in there, do the work that you need to do.
Okay.
And then you put the copper sheathing back on to protect the hull.
And what do you do with the copper that they take off?
So some of the copper that has come off of the ship in past restorations has been given to the museum, and we have been able to make copper medallions, which we sell in our museum store. So if you want the most unique Constitution gift, we are able to recycle some of the copper and some of the wood that comes off of the ship, and that helps to support the proceeds of the museum to help us tell the story in the future.
Oh, yeah, and I would say whatever you can do to make things that are keepsakes from the Constitution. When I had Olivia Browning, anything to do with the Constitution, people really wanted. It's amazing how much love and passion there is for the Constitution. And I've been living there for almost 10 years, and I think, and you work there, but it's just... it's just mind-boggling how popular it is and a national treasure, and it's right in our backyard.
It is. It's a real treat. And now at our store, you can get not only a copper medallion, we now have jewelry, so you could have earrings or a necklace made from Constitution copper. Or
oh, the actual copper.
Copper removed from the ship.
Oh, that's
nice. Or we
also
make pens out of the wood.
So this is a plank of the wood?
So this is a piece of white oak.
Okay.
Right. So the planking, the ship's hull, the very outside, is white oak. There's a sandwich of white oak, then live oak and white oak, about 24 inches thick, the waterline. And Constitution earned the nickname Old Ironsides, but it's all wood. It's because cannonballs bounced off of her wooden hull and someone cried, huzzah, her sides were made of iron. But they didn't make iron ships back then. So strong as iron, but it's because of the wonderful wood in the ship's hull.
Well, that live oak, I know, this is very heavy. And then the live oak was...
is even heavier
than
this.
Is even heavier, yes.
Right.
So let's talk a little bit about some of the, at least two of the cool exhibits that is going to be happening with the Constitution and Dry Dock.
So when you come to visit Constitution, well, right now... you can't visit her for a couple more weeks because they're preparing to bring her into dock.
Well, you can visit the museum.
You can visit the museum every day.
Okay.
We are open every day from 9 a.m. to 6 p.m.
And summer hours.
Those are our summer hours,
yay,
exactly. and you're welcome to come on down, everyone from Charlestown. Please do come down or bring your guests or your friends and family. You can follow the progress of the restoration. But the museum is open each day. We have no set admission fee. If you have a great time, please make a donation, but you can come down every day and check out what's going on. So our new exhibit that's going to look at the repair work underway to Constitution is, as the whole restoration project will have a lot of work underneath the waterline and especially on the very bow of the ship. The cutwater is the portion below the waterline, and they're going to need to do work in that area.
Okay.
So
is this similar to work that, I don't mean to interrupt you, but just to put it in perspective for people, is it similar? I understand the copper coming off, but similar to work they did in the 90s? Just because she sits in the water, is that
right? So it's been about 20 years. So you need to
get
below. You need to look and see how things are doing. We go to the doctor for checkups more frequently than that.
Yes.
But to take her in, and it just takes so much effort to get the copper off to be able to look below the waterline, then decide which planks you're going to need to replace. They do know they're going to have to do work in the bow area. So once you do all that, take her apart, do the work that you need to do, then put it back together, get all the copper sheets back on. It'll take 2.5 years in dock to do the work that they need to do.
Okay, so they're planning for 2.5 years.
So that's the plan. And obviously, when you open up a ship that's over 200 years old, you may find things a little differently than you planned.
Just like a house.
Yep, there's nothing set in stone.
Do you find interesting things in the ship? Are there, you know, like, did sailors put things away or tuck things away that you found?
We don't find so much hidden things. When the ship was in dry dock in the 1990s, they did discover in some places that she was actually in better condition than they may have expected.
Oh, that's
At that time, they were able to actually x-ray the ship. So you could look in and see their metal fasteners when you have lots of pieces of wood coming together, copper fasteners. And Paul Revere provided those initial copper fasteners. So in some cases, they were able to x-ray and say, oh, that looks okay, we don't need to go in there. Or you might see another one and say, oh, we see a crack, let's go ahead and do work there. So it's fun to apply some modern technology along with the oldest traditional shipbuilding technology to work on the ship.
And so did Paul Revere provide the original copper? for her hull.
So he provided copper fittings that hold the rudder on that steer the ship. He provided these big long bolts. When the ship was first built in the 1790s, Paul Revere purchased rolled copper from England. He didn't yet know how to do that, but he wanted to do that. So his son went to England, learned how to roll copper. Paul Revere set up a copper rolling mill down in Canton, south of the city. So by 1803, when they needed to replace the copper on Constitution, it was Paul Revere copper.
Oh, that's wonderful.
So, right, when he got his first government contract, he promised to do it as cheap as anyone and as well. So Paul was a good entrepreneur.
So what happened with that copper? Is that in the museum and I've missed it?
So what came off at that moment in 1803, you're just repairing a ship. She wasn't a legend at that point.
Yeah,
so
true.
You take off the old stuff, you put on the new stuff, you fix the ship and get her back out there. So in more recent times that we take more care and are more careful with her, because now she's America's ship of state. Congress voted to name her America's ship of state, and she is a symbol, as we know, that people from all across the country and around the world come to see.
Yes, and I was just saying to you that my husband always finds it great to bring colleagues from England, or my husband's British, or from anywhere, really. And I found at the store, when I had the store as well, when people would come in, Bunker Hill Monument, obviously, and Constitution, but it was, people would tread through snow and rain and all kinds of weather to do that.
It is remarkable. People will, if they're on the Freedom Trail, they will march along and they will find their way. So when visitors come down in the next few weeks, once the ship comes into dry dock and is out of the water on Tuesday, it'll take a few weeks to hook up the power, the security, fire suppression systems, all of those things before they can let people back on board.
And you said June 9th.
But the goal is June 9th to have all of that back in place. So then when you come to visit Constitution, there'll still be a little security check, but then you can walk on the brow onto the ship in dry dock. You can still take a picture by the ship's wheel or at the ship's bell.
Okay.
And then exactly. So you can talk to a sailor there. When you come off the ship, you can come on over to the museum, and there are sailors in the museum each day. And there you can sign one of the new copper sheets that will be installed on Constitution.
Oh, that's wonderful.
So the ship's hours in the morning, weekday mornings, they'll be working on the ship, but in the afternoons, by 2 o'clock, she'll be reopened. So
okay.
She'll be open 2 to 6 in the afternoons.
All right, summer.
Over the summer, yep. Open each day on the weekend, 10 to 6, but she's still closed on Monday. But
okay.
The museum is open every day.
Okay, and the museum gift shop is open every day too, right?
Absolutely.
There are a lot of treasures in the gift shop, I find. I find with museum gift shops, there's so many amazing, obviously, things that are connected to the site, but Your gift shop has so many interesting books, and I didn't realize the jewelry and pieces of wood. And what else would you recommend that they do while they're at the museum? I know I'm doing an event there this weekend. So the Constitution Museum does offer space for events.
Mm-hmm.
What do you do? I know the Discovery Center gets a lot of traffic. And are you looking forward this summer to hosting a lot of kids groups or camp groups? How does that work in the summer for you all?
So we'll continue. The school groups are arriving now. And then in the summer, there are lots of summer camp groups and lots of families walking the Freedom Trail. So the museum is especially designed to be a great experience for families, for kids of all ages.
Yeah.
So yes, on the first floor, we have a Discovery Center, which has lots of hands-on activities or games that help you think about and talk about the War of 1812. Why is this ship so significant? Our second floor exhibit, All Hands on Deck, really brings you into the life of the sailor in 1812, and that's where you can meet the people who worked at the guns. You can try scrubbing the deck the way they would with a holy stone. You can climb onto the foot rope.
That's
you have to go up.
I need to do
go
that.
Up, furl a sail. Once you're tired, you can rest in the hammock for a little while. So that's an award-winning exhibit upstairs that was one where we actually tested with over 2,000 families, just observed them coming through to make all of our interactives work really well to encourage conversations about history. And we're taking those same ideas. Our newest exhibit will be right when you walk in the museum in the central corridor.
Oh, wonderful.
The new exhibit opening this summer is called Forced to Frigate. Okay. So we'll start with, why are we building these ships? So George Washington is trying to figure out how to protect American commerce in the 1790s. So Congress in 1794 voted to build 6 ships. And we know Constitution is one of the first 6 ships in the Navy.
Yes.
So then we'll look at the experience.
Was the Morgan one as well?
So the Morgan, nope, she's a little later. She's a whaling ship.
Okay.
So Constitution protects her. But we... the idea, you know, to build Constitution, so Joshua Humphreys designed the ships, and thinking about what type of ship would you design, you can try drawing out the lines of a ship the way Joshua Humphreys and his assistants would.
Oh, nice.
We'll have a computer interactive where you can think about designing a ship. If it's really long and skinny, it'll be really fast and maneuverable, but you can't get a lot of guns on. If you design it like a fortress, it'll carry a lot of guns, but it won't be so maneuverable. So you can design your ship. We can each design a ship and then try launching them and see how they fare against each other.
Oh, that's neat.
So that'll be fun. We'll look at the materials to build Constitution and the wood and the different properties, why they chose different pieces of wood for different parts of the ship.
That's a great activity. I find that kids, girls and boys, no matter what age, kind of enjoy shipbuilding or, you know, just talking about the ships. It's so interesting with the water and the materials, and it really does kind of, other than some other museums, it really does kind of keep all their interest.
So we're designing this to be both a hands-on exhibit. You'll meet the people who were involved at the time, but we're also including STEM, some of the science, technology, the engineering, and math, and a challenge in each section so that you can help think, what would I have done if I were involved at that time?
Oh, that would be great. And when does that open?
So July 4th is the target to open that exhibit. And then there's another piece. We're working with an artist who will be drawing the view of Constitution's construction.
Yeah.
He'll be working over the summer, and then we'll make that into a time lapse so you can see the construction of the ship. And we'll launch that on the anniversary of the ship's launch, October 21st, in the fall.
Oh, that's wonderful.
So we have lots of fun pieces coming.
Yes, and I'm sad to say that we're almost over with the time. There's always so much to talk about, and I feel like this show goes so quickly. But go see this fabulous museum if you haven't already. Anne is obviously very knowledgeable. I clearly need to brush up on my Constitution history, but it's so interesting that I think we can all agree that it's something to do. Certainly some place to take the kids, and we'd love to, if I can squeeze you on again, I'd love to have you on again to talk a little bit more about the significance of the next 3 years and when she'll come back in and things like that.
There'll be more to talk about, and you can also follow on the museum's website, we have a restoration blog section, so you can follow as we're posting the photos and information, or if you're going for your run down through the Navy Yard, you'll have a sense of what they're working on and what's happening.
Oh, great. So the 2 days to remember are Sunday, you can see them flooding the gates, and then, correct, and then Tuesday, you'll be able to see her in position.
So it's overnight from Monday night into Tuesday, so it is a late night affair, but she will be hopefully lined up by about 10:30, crossing into the dock by about midnight. She should be all lined up and ready to pump the water out.
Oh, wonderful. All right, well, I hope you have a very successful weekend, and I will be with you at the museum on Saturday. I'm looking, well, not you specifically, but I am looking forward to that event. And thank you so much for joining us this evening. Thank you so much, Anne, for your time and the information about the Constitution. And I hope you go see it. I hope you go see Sarah, which is, she opened the new Charlestown Cycling at 20 City Square. And I hope you have a wonderful weekend. Thank you so much for watching. And remember to shop and dine in 02129. Thanks so much. Good night. We'll be right back.
And remember Charlestown, now and forever. God bless Charlestown. Good night.